reach, these are always three parts. We have the registration process, we have evaluation, and we have the authorization. I want to make it very clear, registration, that's for us something like a green light. It's burdensome, you have to do a lot of work, but if you got the registration, you are very sure that you can produce your substances. The evaluation, this will remain for years. We heard about this issue by Christelle this morning, and it will result in new procedures, new testing, and so on. But authorization, this will represent, in my perception, the highest hurdle of reach. A number of aprotic solvents are on the candidate list. DMF, DMAC, NMP, and so on, dichloetan, a lot of them on the list. Most of them are not on the Annex 14 at the moment, but you can never be sure if they will be implemented in the Annex 14. If we have to do an authorization, then, in my opinion, do it in the right way. But what is the right way? And this was the reason for making a pilot project together with our authorities, with the German authorities. The target of this pilot project was to standardize, to simplify the application of authorization. The main question was, which elements are real essential? And how can we simplify the procedure? And where do we have possibilities for standardization? We have three parts of the authorization process, the risk and exposure description, that means the CSR, the analysis of alternatives, and the socioeconomic analysis. And we did it for all these parts in a very simplified way because we couldn't do it in extensive, but we did it. And one of the really important findings was, and that was Tim just explained, we need good process descriptions, pictures, flowcharts. If you have it, it's much easier for not so involved people to understand our processes. And that is one of our major failures, that we always think everything is so clear because we understand it, but it is very difficult for the others. We have to have a good documentation. And I think this is very, very important. We have to demonstrate transparency. It doesn't make sense to plaque everything in your CSR. You have to go for a public consultation, and you need to give your information, otherwise it can't be assessed. So a detailed function description is necessary for the analysis of alternatives. This is the second part of the process. You have to make a real assessment of the alternatives. That means you have to look for technical feasibility, you have to look for economical feasibility, and you have to compare hazard and risk of your substance and of a possible substitute. And you have to look for your investment costs, for modification of existing plants. That's not an easy task. Compared to your substance, is there a technical feasibility? What about the economic feasibility? And if you have on one point a no, stop it. The third point was the SEA. So you need a precise description of the alternatives, of the properties of the alternatives, of the function of the substance, and never forget the regulatory requirements. They are also very important. And last but not least, the customer requirements. We heard it by the other examples. If you have contracts and you are supplying this substance, purchasing this substance, then you have to have a look on these needs. You can't stop. You have your contracts and you have to assess it. And if you have the adequate control route, you have a threshold. It should be enough if this exposure in your plant is always below the threshold. That was a finding of our pilot project. So you have to look for the negative impact of the society. That's often misunderstood. It is not the use or the benefit for your own company. You always have to look for the benefit for the society. So you have to compare it. So if we talk about a pharmaceutical, and that was the case in our case, then you have to consider what happens if this pharmaceutical is not available on the market. So we think this is a very strong case that we have to get a granting for authorization. Loss of profit, don't forget it. It is something you need. Contract penalties, negative effects on suppliers. But you have to compare it, what happens with your workers, what happens with the environment. So the results of the pilot project was low risk for workers, the SEA benefits exceeds the SEA costs, and the granting of authorization is likely, but simplification of the process is possible. And therefore, we decided in our pilot project that we should concentrate on the critical issues. That saves time and efforts. What are the main boundaries if you ask for simplification? And one of the points I just will give you, it's the absence of the chemical in the final product. You have to use the substance in a closed system. The recycling of the process chemical has to be in the process. If possible, a mass balance should be available. This is one of the points that is not that easy. There's no significant release to the environment, and we really limit it to a significant release to the environment. If there is a really, really small release, it should be possible. And the worker shouldn't be exposed, and you have to show that everything is really well controlled. We should ask about, or we should talk about fit for purpose. That's what Tim just mentioned. Fit for purpose is really necessary. Look what you really need. Don't do everything. Give the right info to the right time. And have always in mind what is really needed. Don't do a doctorate for every substance, for every part of an application of authorization. What would be very helpful is early determination of a DNEL, of a dose response curve, so that you have a threshold, that you can be under this threshold. This facilitates life. Authorization is a big, big burden for industry, but I see some light at the horizon. And one of my major pleas, we need long review periods. And we can only get long review periods if we can explain our case very, very good, and if we show transparency.